I appreciate it, Dr. Shishman. So with regards to aortoiliac complication, so on top of the previous stated disclosures, I'm not going to be showing an exploded aorta today. Part of that is because I was taught by my mentors, including Dr. Shishabor, to be extremely, extremely meticulous with aortic as well as iliac disease. Towards that, I have some personal rules for aortoiliac disease that I've developed. As we mentioned for below knee, you should never be surprised to find aortoiliac disease when you get to the lab, so you can appropriately prepare for it. I IVUS iliacs and aortoiliac disease a lot for a couple of reasons. One, for sizing, and two, to make sure I'm entering occlusions at the point where I think I'm entering and I'm leaving occlusions at the point where I know that I want to be leaving them. I can think of three cases in the last couple of years where I had a wire that I thought went true through a common iliac CTO, came into the aorta, chased it with a microcatheter, the pressure was there, I took a little puff, it looked good, but then by IVUS we were clearly tracking that wire 1 to 2 centimeters into the aorta before actually emerging back into it. So I IVUS all the time. Rarely do I use device-based crossing. I oftentimes will use alternate axis, including the case we're going to discuss for antegrade crossing. Angiography can be tough in the iliac sometimes because of how large the vessels are. Undersized balloon predilatation is your friend because it will reveal small problems before you make them big problems. Protecting the contralateral limb when necessary if you think you'll be stenting across it. And then sometimes, as in everything we do, the best, that perfect can be the enemy of good. So this gentleman is 76, hypertension, hyperlipidemia, kidney disease with a creatinine 1.5, tobacco. Golfer, active, but has a progressive escalating lifestyle limiting claudication in the left leg greater than the right leg. Can't even walk from the cart to the tee at this point. So he was a bag carrier, then he became a cart driver, then he became someone who just couldn't even get outside to do the things that he wanted to do. With regards to non-invasive imaging, every battle is won before it's fought. So again, never be surprised by an iliac. So we start with our ABI, demonstrating on the left side a significantly depressed ABI of 0.62 and dulled waveforms, Doppler waveforms. By duplex, in our lab, even if we're looking at a single limb, we always do the ipsilateral side at the CFA for a couple reasons. One, to be able to appropriately compare the waveform at the CFA. Two, just to know what we need to know about our access site to make sure we're not trying to micropuncture stick severe lesions in the contralateral limb. Certainly, we see the asymmetry on this side as well as a dulled monophasic spectral Doppler in that left CFA. We deferred CTA in the setting of his creatinine, though one time where we'll sometimes use CTAs is when we know we're going to war with complex iliac disease, resist still. We did do an aortoiliac duplex, but it was somewhat limited secondary to bowel gas, and so the plan was, right, CFA access, take some pictures, hope for the best, always expect the worst. And so this is our first picture. So there's disease on the right side and the right common iliac. The left side, by this picture, it almost looks like there's a little bit of a track, and it's not a true CTO, but when you zoom in, you see it's kind of the collateral that's showing you that little bit of a track. It's a little bit of shifting bowel gas that shows you that little bit of that track, and in reality, we're dealing with a left common iliac CTO with a pretty short cuff of normal vessel. We stuck the other side, so we can get pictures from both. We actually did simultaneous injections, same way we do in coronary CTO, to really elucidate what the degree and the level of that highly calcified chronic occlusion in the common iliac was. And we could see a fairly blunt beak. We do see, as we zoom in, these two little stalks, one in an area we don't really want it, kind of coming in medially from the lesion, and then one proximally but without a real normal cuff at that site. And so, the plan was, let's see what we can do coming up from the left CFA. Again, we don't use device-based crossing that much or much of all, at all in iliacs. We did what we do, wires, knuckled wires, glide wires, quote-unquote weaponized, which is such a terrifying term, but increasing the strength of passage using a microcatheter as we went from angled glides to stiff angle glides to straight angle glides. And well, at some point along the way, a wire stuck and then a wire kind of popped. And for like a second, we thought, well, maybe that popped up and over into the other iliac. That would be great. Of course, that was not the case. It popped out into somewhere, to be determined where, chased by that microcatheter. And sure enough, we had this small territory of extravasation of contrast. And so this was an interesting situation, which is why I bring it to this panel, because it's not just an area of perforation. It's fairly small, which is nice, but it's also before crossing. So having not crossed this thing yet, obviously, it's not as simple as, well, instead of a regular stent, we'll just put a covered stent. Instead, we're still sitting here having accomplished nothing but looking at a fairly small but present perforation. And so you ask, well, what do we do in this situation? Do we balloon tamponade it? Do we think about coiling it, though the neck is quite broad in that area? Do you need emergent surgery? Do we cover it somehow, even though we haven't actually connected the dots between the aorta and the common iliac? Do we just stop? Do we give protamine and reverse, particularly before actually opening up the thing and increasing flow, and thus pressure getting down to that area of perforation? We talked through, we considered all these things as we were doing it. One, hemodynamics were stable, so we weren't rapidly becoming tachycardic and hypotensive. And two, we kept taking pictures to see exactly if this thing was expanding or continuing to bleed. What we decided was to stop trying to come up from retrograde, thinking that our wires and our devices would probably keep passing into that track, and we'd give it a go, seeing if we could get via an alternate access strategy across this to then give us an opportunity to try and either cover it if it persisted or make some other decisions about how to treat. We kept taking pictures, and it wasn't expanding. If anything, there was a little bit less contrast extravasation, and our hemodynamics were as stable as they were previously. And so having that little beak, even though we'd have no support coming over with sheaths, we decided to see what we could do in terms of crossing up and over from the contralateral iliac limb. Towards that end, we actually put a 7 French IMA coronary guide in via the right CFA. We chased it with the telescope 035 Trailblazer, and then we brought an 035 soft angle glide wire directly into that beak. And though I don't have a picture as we entered, thankfully that wire passed smoothly. So smoothly, we were actually able to chase it with an 035 Trailblazer. So we brought now an 035 Trailblazer in from the left leg and an 035 Trailblazer up and around from the right leg. And what you see in the image is us actually pulling back that glide wire as we're coming up and through, after we've come up and through with that trail. Trailblazer. We then took out the Trailblazer, we exchanged for a Woolley, and we were looking at this, our left common femoral sheath there, and then our up and over Trailblazer there, and we externalized in order to create a strong platform upon which to do our work going up and over. So snared and externalized the Woolley. Then we took back the Trailblazer from the right leg, and so we were left with an uncovered Woolley wire going up and over the iliac bifurcation. I mentioned caution here because we're oftentimes used to externalizing when we're working through sheaths that are covering the iliac bifurcation. In this situation at this point, we were not, and if you were to pull on both ends of this wire, you would effectively Swiss cheese the iliac bifurcation, which would be less than ideal. But without applying negative force, we removed that Trailblazer microcatheter from the left side. We put it up from the right side. Once the Trailblazer was up and over from the left over the iliac bifurcation to the right, we took our wire out from the right, and we put our soft, gentle Woolley wire back in from the left. So we're now through our total occlusion with that Trailblazer, and what we were then able to do is actually withdraw that right, Trailblazer coming in from the left side all the way back to where we believed the occlusion to be, and then flip our soft, gentle Woolley wire up and through. And so now we had a proven track, which we'd achieved from coming up and over. So we knew we weren't entering into the aorta. We knew exactly where we were entering the lesion, and we had a wire that was up and in into the aorta coming through that CTO. We chased it with a Trailblazer, and then we took that Woolley out, so that was the flipping into the aorta. So here we're advancing that Trailblazer. You can see my hand, which is fun. We're chasing it with that Trailblazer to actually exchange, because even though we think, based on our steps, we're in the right place, we would IVUS this. So we just use the 014 IVUS in this situation, which can typically give you enough reach out for common iliacs and aortas. Unfortunately, don't have our IVUS pictures, but we were able to prove by IVUS that we were both entering the aorta immediately at the beak where we knew we were, as well as exiting into the common iliac. Again, other steps, once we had that wire there, we took pictures from the other side. So we rewired the right, we put an omniflush into the aorta from the right side. We took a picture, we were able to prove that our wire wasn't magically coming into that perforation or anywhere near that perforation. We were going true to true, including that beak right at the cuff of the left common iliac. And then we did a little undersized balloon angioplasty and took a picture from the right side. And so after we took that picture, we could see flow. We actually didn't see that extravasation anymore, so whether it tamponaded itself or healed itself, but we were seeing flow coming in line exactly where we want it to be. After that, we used our IVUS to actually size to that left CIA cuff. There really wasn't a cuff. It was really the true ostia of the CIA. There was significant disease on the right side. We decided to do kissing iliac stents, which I think many of us hate doing. This gentleman actually had a fairly broad angle for the emergent of his common iliacs, so we overlapped even a little more than we would just for fear of the balloons going up and actually pushing the stents back in. And so we did our KISS. We actually upsized based on IVUS evaluation of the right common to 10 and then 9 at the aneurysmal segment, and then we took a picture. And we haven't used covered stents, though we talked about that for quite a bit of time, because after all, the goal of all of this was to think about covering that perforation. And so after deploying our two size stents within the common iliacs bilaterally, we're left with a pretty good angiographic result. Now, we thought, initially that the reason why we were crossing was actually to then cover this with a covered stent. The only reason I didn't end up using ICASTs or VBXs in that area was because of that broad base to the common iliacs, and as they were coming up, I was a little bit anxious about covered stents kind of compressing into one another. So we didn't, and the thought was, well, we'll stent across the occlusions, we'll then decide if there's still evidence of perforation that there hadn't been if we want to cover it, with the caveat that it's oftentimes harder to use a covered stent to cover a perforation if you've already laid down a scaffold ahead of it. But thankfully, our end result looked quite good. Hemodynamics were perfectly stable. He returned to walking and did quite well. So.